Alleluia, Alleluia. Everybody sing Alleluia, for the Lord has risen, it is true. Everybody sing Alleluia. 30 years.
In this playlist, we already discussed how the Catholic Charismatic Movement has its roots in Pentecostalism and Protestantism. Now I'm going to do a couple videos on the ecumenical nature of the Catholic Charismatic Movement. Kevin Rannigan's book, Catholic Pentecostals, mentions the word ecumenical or ecumenism 14 times. A supposed unity of Catholics and Protestants is a major theme of the book. But why should Catholics feel any sense of unity with Protestants? The name Protestant means protester. And what does Protestantism protest? It protests the truths of the one true faith, Catholicism. Protestantism is contrary to truth. Its theology is flawed. Its inevitable end is chaos. Protestants have nothing of significant value to offer Catholics because Protestantism is built on a foundation of error. It is inherently tainted. When people fall in with Protestants, their thinking becomes muddled. In this video, we'll look at specific examples of ecumenism in Kevin Rannigan's book and how it led to the creation of the Catholic Charismatic Renewal. In the next video, we'll discuss how the ecumenism inherent in the Catholic Charismatic Renewal has led to indifferentism. So, the origin of the Catholic Charismatic Renewal began with adults acting like children. They were skulking about doing something they knew was forbidden. It was like a creepy middle school party in the basement of unknowing parents. These people wanted to play around with occultism and experience the thrill of speaking in tongues. They could, with faith and confidence, pray for and lay hands on each other in an attempt to follow the pattern found in Scripture. This seemed like a kind of spiritual turning in on one another, and they thought it wasn't the best way. Perhaps, after all, it seemed they should go to somebody else. The only thing they could think of was some Pentecostal church. So these guys figured praying with other Catholics wasn't good enough. They wanted Pentecostal preachers to lay hands on them. So they wanted to go to a Pentecostal church. However, they knew this was forbidden by the Code of Canon Law of 1917. It is not licit for the faithful, by any manner, to assist actively or have a part in the sacred rites of non-Catholics. This prohibition is based on Scripture, which warns us, what part has the faithful with the unbeliever? And some might say this was all done away with by the Second Vatican Council, and we'll discuss that more in the next video. Rannigan's book continues, I didn't exactly know any live Pentecostal, and I couldn't just walk up to one and say, can I come to your church? Again, these people remind me of kids. It was like some kids who wanted to try drugs for the first time, but couldn't figure out how to find a drug dealer. These people had all been catechized before the Second Vatican Council. Every fiber of their being should have warned them about this foolhardy venture. Is it wrong for a Catholic, merely for the sake of curiosity, to attend a revival meeting? Answer, yes. Anything that will tend to injure or impair our faith is objectionable. Besides, you know the old story about what curiosity did for the cat. Scripture says, and we charge you, brethren, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you withdraw yourselves from every brother walking disorderly, and not according to the tradition which they have received from us. While groping around, they suddenly remembered an Episcopalian priest who had come to the Catholic College Duquesne once to lecture a group of students. As kind of a long shot, a call was placed to the Episcopalian Chancery in downtown Pittsburgh. John himself, the Apostle of Love, strictly forbade any intercourse with those who professed a mutilated and corrupt form of Christ's teaching. On this day, January 13th, they met at the home of Miss Florence D., a Presbyterian who had organized the prayer group sometime earlier. So after first calling the Episcopalian, these fledgling charismatics decided to start cavorting with Presbyterians. It is clear why this apostolic see has never allowed its subjects to take part in the assemblies of non-Catholics. For the union of Christians can only be promoted by promoting the return to the one true Church of Christ of those who are separated from it. It was a strikingly non-denominational meeting. It ended when Pat and I asked to be prayed with for the baptism in the Holy Spirit. They simply asked me to make an act of faith for the power of the Spirit to work in me. I prayed in tongues rather quickly. Is a non-denominational meeting supposed to mean that it wasn't overly Protestant? And it's interesting why the paragraph refers to the baptism of the Holy Spirit, but then immediately it just refers to the Spirit, asking the Spirit to work on him. Is it the Holy Spirit they're dealing with or some darker spirit? It is weird how they phrase it. but they weren't allowed to be there in the first place. Is it proper for a Catholic at a large public meeting to stand and take part in the invocation with which it opens? Catholics should stand and act most reverently when present at a meeting which is opened by a prayer by a Protestant clergyman. However, it is against the teachings of our faith to associate as vital factors in such prayers. No one will find fault with this inconsistency on the part of the Catholics, since the Church holds that religious worship belongs to her and to her alone. This does not mean that bigotry should be encouraged or that God does not hear the prayers of our non-Catholic friends, but simply that all Catholic praying is to be done under Catholic auspices. So then the book goes into quotes from testimonies from the first Catholic charismatics. One of the most beautiful things to experience is the real feeling of unity with fellow Christians, especially those who have received the baptism. There can be no unity with heretics until they return to the one true faith. As Pope Pius XI wrote, "As zeal for the unity of the Church increases among the faithful, so, in the same ratio, the work which he had so much at heart will increase, until the time shall come when the promise of Christ, as well as the desire of all his saints, will be fulfilled, and there will be one fold and only one shepherd." So, again, these people who call themselves Catholic were going to prayer meetings in Protestant homes. A few newcomers went to a prayer meeting in the home of Ray and Mabel B. of the Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship International, an interfaith group of laymen. Interfaith groups exist under the liberal proposition that all churches are equal. They assume that there is no one true religion. But Pope Pius IX condemned the proposition that Protestantism is nothing more than another form of the same true Christian religion, in which form it is given to please God equally as in the Catholic Church. That proposition is condemned. Whoever is without the Church will not be reckoned among the sons, and whoever does not want to have the Church as mother will not have God as father. 1 week later, at a prayer meeting at the home of a dear Pentecostal friend, my wife yielded to, and I, with 7 of our friends, received the gift of tongues. It's okay to have non-Catholic friends, but it's a matter of concern when a person prays with Protestant friends. But when you and your wife start babbling in tongues with your Protestant friends, you've definitely crossed the line. Bear not the yoke with unbelievers, for what participation has justice with injustice? Or what fellowship has light with darkness? Well, I hope you enjoyed this video. I'll be back again within a week with another one. But in the meantime, please check out my Facebook page and my Twitter page. Every day I post additional content that you won't find on this YouTube channel. And also, please pray for the Church.